So today we'll talk about the last part of our discussion of stroke localization, that is lacunar stroke syndrome. So before we talk about the lacunar stroke syndrome, I want to tell you something about the internal capsule and its blood supply.
This is caudate nucleus, this is thalamus, and this is putamen and globus pallidus, the lentiform nucleus. And here runs the internal capsule. This is medial geniculate body and this is lateral geniculate body. So now let me tell you, this is anterior limb of internal capsule, which primarily contains the anterior thalamic radiation. Now this anterior thalamic radiation is composed of thalamocortical fibers, anterior thalamic radiation consisting of thalamocortical fibers. This is genu. Genu primarily contains the corticonuclear fibers. So genu is consisting of corticonuclear fibers. This is the posterior limb of internal capsule, the most important part, this one. This is the posterior limb, which consists of corticospinal fibers. Corticospinal fibers for upper limb, for trunk and lower limb. So, corticospinal fibers for upper limb, trunk and lower limb. And this is the retrolentiform part. This retrolentiform part, it consists of the geniculocalcarine fibers, the optic radiation which originates from lateral geniculate body and goes towards the visual cortex, calcarine cortex. It is also known as the optic radiation, and also known as posterior thalamic radiation. And there is another sublentiform part which transmits the auditory radiation to the temporal lobe. The sublentiform part consisting of auditory or inferior thalamic radiation. I hope the parts are clear to you. Internal capsule primarily consists of five parts: anterior limb, genu, posterior limb, retrolentiform part and sublentiform part. Anterior limb, it consists of anterior thalamic radiation, which consists of primarily the thalamocortical fibers. The genu consists of corticonuclear fibers. The posterior limb consists of corticospinal fibers for upper limb, trunk and lower limb. This retrolentiform part transmits the optic radiation, and sublentiform part it transmits the auditory radiation. Now we'll talk about the blood supply. Before that, I'll draw the circle of Willis. This is internal carotid artery. This is anterior cerebral artery. This is anterior communicating artery. This is middle cerebral artery. This is anterior choroidal artery. This is posterior communicating artery. This is posterior cerebellar artery arising from the bifurcation of basilar artery, which in turn originates from the fusion of vertebral artery. So if I label, this is anterior cerebral artery, this is anterior communicating artery, this is middle cerebral artery, this is anterior choroidal artery, this is internal carotid artery, this is posterior communicating artery. So there are basically five branches of internal carotid artery: anterior cerebral artery, middle cerebral artery, posterior communicating artery, anterior choroidal artery, and ophthalmic artery. This is posterior cerebral artery, which originates from bifurcation of basilar artery. This is basilar artery, which is formed from the fusion of vertebral artery. This is vertebral artery. So this is the circle of Willis. Now, anterior cerebral artery gives off a branch which is known as recurrent artery of Huebner. This is known as recurrent artery of Huebner. Now I'll tell you the blood supply of internal capsule. So let me draw it much larger view. This is the anterior limb, this one is the genu, this is the posterior limb. We label, this is anterior limb of internal capsule, this is genu, this is posterior limb, this is sublentiform part, and this is retrolentiform part. Now talking about the blood supply, this recurrent artery of Huebner, it gives off one branch each to anterior limb and to the genu of internal capsule. Genu receives another branch directly from the internal carotid artery. Middle cerebral artery, it gives off two branches, middle striate branch and lateral striate branch, each supplying the posterior limb of internal capsule. Anterior choroidal artery, it gives off three branches, supplying each to the posterior limb, sublentiform part, and the retrolentiform part. And posterior cerebral artery, it supplies the retrolentiform part and the sublentiform part. Okay, I hope this is clear in all this. Recurrent artery of Huebner, it supplies the anterior limb and genu. Genu receives another blood supply directly from the internal carotid artery. Middle cerebral artery mainly supplies the posterior limb of internal capsule through two striate branches, medial and lateral. Anterior choroidal artery supplies each to posterior limb, retrolentiform part, and sublentiform part. And posterior cerebral artery supplies to the retrolentiform and sublentiform part. Now we will discuss the consequences of occlusion of these arteries. So our topic is lacunar stroke syndrome. So what is the most important risk factor for lacunar stroke is age and hypertension. The risk factors are age and hypertension. And what is the pathophysiology? It occurs due to lipohyaluronic occlusion of penetrating artery. So it is a small vessel disease basically. There is small ischemic infarction in deep areas of the brain or brainstem due to occlusion of penetrating artery. So there is lipohyalinotic occlusion of penetrating artery. So these small ischemic infarction, they can range in size from 0.5 mm to 15 mm. Now they can classically result in 5 stroke syndromes. What are those? Either they can result in pure motor stroke. Pure motor stroke means contralateral hemiplegia, including face, arm, lower leg. Okay, so there is contralateral hemiplegia. There is no sensory loss, no apraxia, no aphasia. There is only contralateral motor weakness. This is pure motor stroke. It occurs if there is a lesion in the corona radiata, posterior limb of internal capsule, or the basis pontis. That means the ventral pontine injury that we have discussed right now. Only there is descending, there is longitudinal bundles of descending corticospinal tracts in the ventral pons area. So if there is an injury to the basis pontis, posterior limb of internal capsule, or corona radiata. Another syndrome is pure sensory stroke. That means there is hemisensory, isolated hemisensory loss on the contralateral side. So it occurs if there is an injury in the area of ventroposterolateral nucleus of thalamus. Ventroposterolateral nucleus of thalamus, if affected, can result in pure sensory stroke. Another one is sensory motor stroke, in which there is hemisensory loss and hemiplegia on the contralateral side. It occurs there when there is involvement of posterior limb of internal capsule or internal capsule plus thalamus. Another one is ataxic hemiparesis. Ataxic hemiparesis, also known as homolateral ataxia and crural paresis. That means there is contralateral leg weakness plus incoordination of ipsilateral arm and leg, ipsilateral side. There is incoordination of arm and leg. This occurs, this ataxic hemiparesis occur again if there is lesion in posterior limb of internal capsule or basis pontis. Means pons, ventral pons. And the last one is dysarthria clumsy hand syndrome. It occurs when there is injury in the deep pons. So there will be dysarthria, there will be dysphagia, there will be loss of fine motor control of hands, and there is supranuclear facial weakness. Okay, so because of supranuclear facial weakness, there is dysarthria, there is dysphagia, there is loss of fine motor control of hand. This is seen in dysarthria clumsy hand syndrome. So this is all about the lacunar stroke syndromes.
Now we'll talk about some important thing. One is one-liners, which is called as the Charcot's artery of cerebral hemorrhage. So Charcot's artery of cerebral hemorrhage is lateral striate branch of middle cerebral artery. Lateral striate branch of middle cerebral artery. So what will be the effect? The effect will be contralateral pure motor or dense hemiplegia. That means including face, arm and lower limbs. Another important thing is artery of cerebral thrombosis. Which artery is known as the artery of cerebral thrombosis? So the answer would be anterior choroidal artery. So anterior choroidal artery, I have told you, it supplies, it gives off branch east to posterior limb of internal capsule, to sublentiform part and to retrolentiform part. So what would be the effect? There would be contralateral hemiplegia, hearing defect, and vision defect. That means contralateral homonymous hemianopia. And also there is usually contralateral hemisensory loss is also present. Another question, if I ask which artery is most susceptible to iatrogenic occlusion, during aneurysm clipping, during surgery of aneurysm clipping, which artery is most susceptible to iatrogenic occlusion? So the answer would again be anterior choroidal artery. And the effect would be similar. Now last is, what would happen if there is an occlusion of recurrent artery, recurrent artery of Hubner, which is a branch of anterior cerebral artery. So there is weakness of contralateral face and arm alone. There is no involvement of lower limb and there is no sensory deficit also. So there is contralateral weakness of face and arm. So this is all I have to discuss in stroke localization. Hope you enjoy this session. We'll soon return with another important topic from neurology, speech disorder. Thank you very much for your patience.